Individuation, Knowing Who You Really Are by Aion Farvahar. The most influential person in your life is your own self, and the most important knowledge that you need in life is the knowledge of your true self. Your life finds its true meaning only when you find your true self, and individuation is the process that leads you there. Hi, this is Aion Farvahar. I'm glad you're here. This channel is about self-realization and honoring our life purpose and meaning. If you're interested in these topics, please subscribe to stay connected. Your support is the foundation of this channel and encourages me to create more content in the future. For more information about myself and my life mentoring practice, please find my bio link in the description below. Also, for more information about the artist behind the expressive images I use here, please find the description below. Today, we want to focus on individuation, a concept coined by the pioneer of depth psychology, C.G. Jung. Individuation is a process that leads to your highest level of self-awareness possible. Human psyche is deep and multilayer. It has many psychological and spiritual layers of depth. Your mind is aware of the layers on the surface, but is not aware of many hidden and deeper layers. Ironically, what we are not aware of has far more influence on how we feel, believe, or do in life. That is the reason we sometimes don't understand why we feel or behave in a certain way. Until we truly understand the totality of our own self, we don't know who we really are, and what we pursue in life may not give us what we really want. Knowing your true self should be the primary goal of your life, because whatever happens after that comes to you naturally and feels right. This presentation explains what true self is and the individuation process that takes us there. To do that, I use some concepts from Jungian psychology, because I believe Jung was fully aware of the depth and the totality of his psyche, which he called the self with a capital S. More specifically, we cover the following topics: conscious and unconscious dimensions of the mind, anatomy of the psyche, ego, persona, animus, the center, and the self. Qualities of the self, how it's like to be individuated, and how to start the individuation process. Please note that the ideas presented here are based on my experience and understanding of individuation and may not reflect the classic Jungian view. Some of the ideas here are psycho-spiritual and dense, and may require further review and contemplations. Conscious and unconscious dimensions of the mind. It is known from depth psychology that human mind has conscious and unconscious dimensions. The conscious dimension of our mind contains everything we already know about ourselves. For example, what we feel, think, believe, like, dislike, or want. Our conscious knowledge of ourself is usually referred to as lower self or ego, and reflects our understanding of who we are. Understanding of who we are cannot represent who we really are, because there are deeper aspects of our being that we still don't know. The unconscious dimension can be divided into personal unconscious and archetypal or collective unconscious. The personal unconscious contains hidden aspects of our being. These could be unwanted or rejected parts of our personality that are exiled or disowned by our psyche, usually because these parts of our personality are emotionally wounded or hold intense energy. Ironically, most of our feelings, thoughts, and behaviors are driven by emotional impulses coming from the unconscious dimension of our being. That is why we sometimes cannot find why we feel or behave in a certain way, because the root of our feelings and behaviors are buried deep within our personal unconscious. In Jungian psychology, the part of the personal unconscious that holds the exiled and unwanted aspects of our personality is known as personal shadow. And shadow work is a psycho-spiritual inner work that helps us explore, heal, and reintegrate these exiled and unwanted parts. Our personal unconscious is not limited to the shadow and also contains positive aspects of our being. For example, the hidden gifts and potentialities within us that we have not yet noticed or actualized. So for us to discover and actualize our hidden gifts and potentialities, we need to access our personal unconscious. Until we explore our personal unconscious, our understanding of who we are remains incomplete. Aside from its personal dimension, the unconscious also has an impersonal, archetypal, or collective dimension. Archetypes are ancient universal patterns that influence our psyche. Many psychological and psychic issues are caused by archetypal unconscious, manifesting in an unhealthy way. The archetypal unconscious can be grouped in different ways. For example, planetary or astrological archetypes are believed to have influence on human psyche and the events in the history of the world. Archetypes can also be spiritual, like celestial beings, angels, demons, or even primordial, like God. Archetypes have a distinct spiritual energy. For example, archetypes of darkness and light, life and death, good and evil, love and hate, or father and mother have a distinct spiritual energy about them. The influence of archetypes on our psyche is subtle and unconscious. For example, someone may notice a sense of anger or darkness inside without knowing why it is there. Not every feeling and belief we notice inside is necessarily ours. Some are archetypal in nature and could have transferred to us through our ancestors or others around us. Unhealthy influence of archetypal or collective unconscious usually presents itself as a persistent belief or a compulsive behavior that is outside of the norm, as if the individual embodying it is possessed by the archetype. I hope you can see how the level of your self-awareness depends on whether or not you choose to explore the unconscious, especially your personal unconscious. Individuation happens when you choose to explore your personal unconscious and gradually bring its content to your conscious awareness. Anatomy of the psyche: ego, persona, animus, the center, and the self. Individuation is the ultimate expansion and transformation of the psyche. So to understand individuation, we need to understand the anatomy of our psyche and its deeper and hidden layers. The model of the psyche I use here is inspired by C.G. Jung's classification of psychic layers and their functions and relationships. As mentioned previously, our psyche is influenced by conscious and unconscious contents. This means that our psyche is half immersed in consciousness and half in the unconscious. Let's use a metaphor to clarify this. Your psyche is like a multi-story house. Your ego or conscious mind only knows the rooms on the ground floor of this house. So it is up to you to explore the other hidden floors in your house. If you don't, your awareness of yourself remains limited to your ego and its ground floor understanding of your house. But if you're open to explore the other floors, you soon discover your whole house, which represents the depth, wholeness, and totality of your psyche. The goal of individuation is to become aware of the wholeness and totality of your psyche, or as Jung called it, become aware of the self. with a capital S. Inspired by Jung's view, the psyche has the following conscious and unconscious layers. Ego is the current understanding of ourself. Persona is our social mask, or how we want to be seen and known by others. Personal unconscious contains exiled and unwanted parts of the psyche, as well as the hidden talents, gifts, and potentialities which we are not yet aware of. The anima, animus, or in short, animus, represents our soul, or the complementary spiritual half of our being. The center is the innermost axis of our being. We can experience the center during mindful meditations or shamanic journeys. The daimonion, or personal daimon, is the image of divine in our psyche and the spiritual companion of our soul. The self with a capital S represents the wholeness and the totality of the psyche, including its conscious and unconscious dimensions. The awareness and embodiment of the self represents the highest level of self-awareness possible and is the ultimate goal of the individuation process. With these basic definitions, let's say more about each of these psychic layers and how they relate to each other within the boundaries of the self. The self has conscious and unconscious dimensions. The conscious part of the self is called the ego, which is the collection of our personal identities through which we define who we are. If you ask me to tell you everything about myself, my ego is the one that responds to you and shares its understanding of me and who I am through my age, my education, personality, interests, and so on. My ego is unaware of my personal unconscious and cannot tell you anything more. Ego has two sides. One is private and the other social. The social side of the ego is called persona, or the personality we embody in our social interactions. My persona is not how my ego understands me, but how it wants others to perceive me. For example, if I'm sad and pessimistic, but I don't want my family or coworker to notice that, I may portray a positive and optimistic view of myself out there, because that hides and masks what I truly feel inside. We have several personas depending on who we are interacting with, and our ego uses them to mask its private side. If you pay attention, you can notice your personas and how they're different from your private self. Our ego and its personas form the conscious dimension of our psyche. Now let's focus on the unconscious dimension of the self and its various layers. The personal unconscious has several parts. One is the shadow, which contains the exiled and unwanted parts of the psyche. Examples are vulnerable and wounded parts, or parts that hold intense emotions or extreme beliefs, and are therefore deemed undesirable by the psyche. For example, if I have an angry part who could get to a road rage, a protective part of my psyche suppresses and exiles that to contain its energy and keep me and others safe on the road. Another part of the personal unconscious, which I call here the hidden treasure, contains positive and hidden talents, gifts, and potentialities in me that I'm not yet aware of. Now let's focus on one of the deeper layers of the personal unconscious, which is the animus, or the soul. Our soul is the spiritual essence that is experiencing our life. Jung viewed and experienced his soul as an autonomous and self-existing aspect of his psyche, who did not exist through him, but through whom he existed. Individuation is not possible without engaging our soul, either intuitively or directly, because we need to understand and fulfill the needs and aspirations of our soul. If you're interested to know more about the soul and how to build a relationship with it, Check out some of my previous posts related to the soul linked in the description below. This brings us to the most important aspect of the unconscious, which is the center. You can experience the center during meditations. In shamanism, the center is the spiritual heart and the point of access to divine wisdom and guidance. Your spiritual heart or heart chakra is the gateway to the center and a part of it. To help you understand the center and its role in the psyche, let's use a metaphor. Imagine the structure of a tree. A tree has branches, a trunk, and roots. Branches are how the tree extends and represents itself in the world. The trunk of the tree supports and nourishes all its branches. It is also well grounded through its roots, deep within the earth. Metaphorically, the branches here can be thought of various aspects or parts of our personality, representing us in the outside world. The trunk of the tree is the center of our being, nourishing and supporting our personality. The roots represent the depth of the center and how it is connected to the divine energy and spiritual ground of being. Hope this metaphor helped you distinguish the importance of the center as your heart or the most inner core of your being. The center is also the central axis of the self, and without experiencing the center, we cannot experience the self. Finding and experiencing the center is the most important and essential step in individuation, because only through the center or the heart, one can explore, heal, and integrate the personal unconscious. The last but not least part of the unconscious is the daimonion or personal daimon, which is also known as the guardian spirit, divine double, celestial twin, or farvashi in shamanic or some mystical traditions. Daimon or daimonion is a term originated in Greek mythology. Personal daimon is the soul companion within each individual. It is the inner mentor that guides the individual to his true destiny. Please note that the term daimon should not be confused with the theological concept of demon, which refers to a dark or ill-intentioned entity. Jung experienced his personal daimon as Philemon and captured his dialogues with him in his private journals published in the Red Book. Henri Corbin, French theologian and Sufi scholar, referred to daimonion as the angel of individuation, because individuation is not possible without recognition of the daimonion, which is the image of divine within an individual, guiding the soul to its true destiny. Daimonion is only accessible through the center. In summary, individuation happens when you get to notice and connect to your center and use its energy to embrace the totality of your being, both conscious and unconscious. Individuation makes you feel whole, alive, and eternal. Qualities of the self. How it's like to be individuated. Individuation requires work and commitment, but it transforms one's experience of life in ways not imagined possible. Individuation can never be fully complete, because there will always be archetypal aspects of human psyche that will remain a mystery to all of us. But committing to the individuation process and the inner work it requires makes you a wise, fully authentic, and awakened individual. As you progress toward your individuation and wholeness, you may notice the following changes in the way you experience yourself. You become more centered, calm, and grounded, even when people around you or the circumstances you're in are challenging. You're aware of and fully embrace your strengths and weaknesses. You realize that things that may not seem perfect in you are also those that make you unique and authentic. Your ego or understanding of yourself expands and approaches your authentic self and who you really are. Your persona is no longer a social mask and represents your authentic nature because you no longer care about how people perceive you or judge your way of life. You don't judge or criticize yourself and are no longer affected by external judgment or criticism. You trust and value yourself and therefore no longer seek validation from others. No compliments or flattering inflates your ego or sense of worth. You notice your authenticity and uniqueness, but don't see yourself higher than others, because you know that deep inside, others also have an authentic and unique essence. You don't identify strongly with your look, personality, or worldly achievements, and view yourself as an emanation of divine imagination manifesting through you. You have a sense of purpose in life and are open to honor that, even if that requires some sacrifices. Some of these personal transformations may seem too idealistic and not achievable, but once you are connected to your center and your true self, all of these happen naturally. How to start the individuation process. So far, we covered the conscious and the unconscious aspects of the psyche and the role of individuation as a process to integrate them within the boundaries of the self. Individuation requires both psychological and spiritual inner work. Based on personal experience, here are a few suggestions to start your individuation journey. Consider some psychological inner work to find and heal any exiled or unwanted parts of you that are stuck in your personal unconscious. This may need IFS or Jungian shadow work or inner child work. Consider journaling more often to engage with your thoughts or feelings in a form of an inner dialogue. You can also use this technique to engage your soul, who otherwise remains hidden in your personal unconscious. Pay attention to your social personas and how well they reflect your authentic self. If not so well, consider changing your personas to represent you more authentically. If there is a part of you that is worried about you being you in social settings, become curious about this part and its worries. Consider practicing mindfulness, IFS, or heart-based meditations to experience your heart center. Any meditation that helps you separate yourself from your mundane feelings and thoughts can help you find and experience your center and heart. Consider doing shamanic journeys or active imagination to connect to your soul or your spirit guides. Your soul and your daimonion are inner guides, and you can engage them in an intuitive or imaginal sense. Pay attention to synchronicities, signs, or symbols you notice repeatedly in your life or dreams. Consider creating an altar based on these symbols. Having a symbolic altar is a significant part of individuation, because the altar reminds you of your center, which is your inner altar. Consider spending more time contemplating on ideas that you're intuitively drawn to. Individuation is a self-reflective process, so you need to cultivate your curiosity toward yourself and contemplate on ideas that are becoming intuitively attractive to you. Your life is a story that is being written by you as you live it. For this story to find its real meaning, you need to know its hero. And to do that, you need to explore the inner depth of your being, because that's the only place you find the hero of your story. In closing, remember that your true life starts when you realize your true self. Until then, your life serves your ego and its self-preservation and self-gratification desires. I want to leave you with the following quote from C.G. Jung. The world will ask who you are, and if you don't know, the world will tell you. If you have found this presentation inspiring, please like and share it with your like-minded friends. Please subscribe to my channel and share your thoughts and comments. For more information about myself and my life mentoring practice, please find my bio link in the description below. Blessings.